called The Vineyard. John Wimber wasn't read before he became a Christian, before he became a follower of Christ. He was a musician with a band called The Righteous Brothers. You'll never hear this again. Lonely rivers flow to the sea. La, 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 la. Never see that. You'll never witness that again. There's a reason for that. So he was part of The Righteous Brothers, who were a secular band, and they used to do music. The Lord drew him to him. He was saved. And then he had a background in the Quaker Church and Calvary Chapel. And he would say, the Vineyard story is about ordinary people who worship and serve an extraordinary God. We believe we're called to be worshippers of God and rescuers of men. That's what every Christian and every church is called to be. Worshippers of God and rescuers of men. And why? Because in Matthew 28, probably why you need technology, so you don't have to have tiny little bookmarks in a Bible like that. However, old school. In Matthew 28, it says, Jesus, just before he's about to go back to the Father, says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. And what is it that he commanded us? The greatest of the commandments is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbour as yourself. We can't do one without the other. We can't love God, worship God without rescuing men. We can't rescue men fully without worshipping God. It goes together. And that's what we do. That's what every Christian is called to. That's what every church is called to. But at the Vineyard, we articulate it in everyday language like worshippers of God and rescuers of men. The Vineyard is simply one thread in the rich tapestry of the historic and global church of Jesus Christ. It's one thread. We love all the churches. God is doing amazing things for all the churches, and we are one thread as part of that tapestry. But it's a thread of God's weaving. God does the weaving. So it's an international movement. There are Vineyard churches all over the world. They will look slightly different in practice. They might not all be the same type of venue. They meet in different places. They speak in different languages. The music often has a different tempo or a different flavour. But they share a DNA. They share values because we are part of a family and we do things in a similar way and for similar reasons. In the UK, there are about 130 churches in the UK and Ireland, and this number grows every year. John and Debbie Wright are the national directors of the Vineyard Movement in the UK, and they planted and still oversee Trent Vineyard in Nottingham, which is where some of us go sometimes to our national leaders conference, where the leaders within the Vineyard all over the UK gather together for training and teaching and encouragement. We are part of the London region. The whole of the UK and Ireland are split into regions with overseers. We're part of the London region, and we're overseen by Bev and Jason Clark, who are from Sutton Vineyard. So sometimes at welcome lunches and things, we get asked who oversees you, who takes care of you, that kind of thing. So I'm letting you know the structure of what we do and who we are. So have you ever found yourself, so that's the Vineyard movement. We're part of a movement of churches worldwide and nationally. Have you ever found yourself saying or doing something that is exactly like your parents? Where did that come from? I didn't even mean to do that, I just said that. I think particularly if and when you have children, you start to shout something at them and you think, that's what my mum used to say. I didn't even know I was saying that. And are you the kind of person who is ever around other people talking and you start to pick up their accent or their mannerisms? You know, sometimes I'm around someone from Manchester and I start to speak Mancunian. I won't attempt that one. Sang earlier, I'm not doing that. Or their mannerisms. You're around them so long, you start to have the same mannerisms. Well, that's what I'm going to talk. We're going to talk about the Vineyard DNA, and that's what I'm talking about. As family, we do things with a particular flavour. As a Vineyard family, we do things in a particular way. It's not better than the other churches or worse than the other churches. It's the way we do it because we are a particular branch of the family of God. And it's our values. It underpins what we do and why we do it. And usually when you start to ask, well, why do we do that way? Or why do we do this? That these values are the reason for that. Now next week, Tom's going to talk specifically about our vision for this church and how we articulate that particularly, but this is a broad brushstroke this morning. And then we're going to get practical. So our vineyard DNA. First of all, everything, the lens through which we see things, a bit like my glasses. If I don't have them on, it might be better to preach like this actually, because then I can't see if you're laughing at my jokes or not. Can't see your faces. But if I put these on, the lenses in my glasses help me to see clearly. The lens that we look at life, and we believe comes from scripture, is called the kingdom of God. The now and the not yet of the kingdom. I'm only going to touch on this briefly because we're about to embark on a series on Daniel, where we're going to be explaining this week on week. So kingdom theology, the now and the not yet of the kingdom of God. So very briefly, Tom has spoken before about this in terms of the grubby orange. Dan Stace, I know you love that. Grubby orange, but it's a bit like this. So when we're talking about early in the family of God, it's a bit like when God takes the Israelites as his people, and he'll be their God, it's a bit like an engagement. So when you are engaged, you're not actually married yet, but you are betrothed. Exclusively. So you have the engagement period and the Israelites are waiting for the king to come and establish his reign and rule. And a kingdom is wherever a king has his reign, dynamic reign and rule. When God sent his son Jesus, that is like the marriage ceremony. Jesus says the kingdom of God is near. The kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is within you. He brings the kingdom of God to the earth, which is like a marriage ceremony. However, you're not fully married. You make the vows, you have the ceremony, you have the party. You're not fully married until the marriage is consummated. In layman's terms, you're not fully married until you have sex. Okay? So what we're waiting for, when Jesus says he comes, he establishes his kingdom, he goes back to be with the Father, and he's going to return again at a point where we're still waiting for to consummate the marriage, when his kingdom comes in full, and he says there'll be no more death, no more dying, no more sin, no more anger or hurt or pain, and we long for that day. But we live now in the period between the marriage and the consummation. So while we're waiting for him to come, his kingdom is here, it's within us. And wherever anyone believes in Jesus and allows him into their heart, wherever the Holy Spirit is, his kingdom is here, but it's here in part. So we see the amazing things of God. We see miracles. We see him moving people's lives, salvation, see healings. However, we still have suffering. We still have to battle suffering until he returns again. So that's what when we say the now and the not yet kingdom, the now of the kingdom, it has arrived, but it's arrived in part, and the not yet, we're waiting for the full completion of it. So that's a particular value in the vineyard, and a lot of what we do comes from that understanding when we look at scripture, that's how we understand it, and how we understand the world. The second thing that I'm going to touch on very briefly is called the main and the plain. So really in our DNA, we just stick to the main teaching in the Bible. The word, the main stuff. And we don't get sidetracked with extraneous teachings. So we don't go off on all sorts of other things. But if it's here, the main and the plain, Jesus, salvation, being filled with the Holy Spirit, God the Father, we teach that and we stick with that. Even if it's in there, we stick with it. So that's very brief on that one. Please. The third thing is we are churches, and in the vineyard, we're churches that plant churches. Because we believe healthy churches grow and plant other churches. And that is what a bit like, I've used this before, my spider plant, which has gone absolutely crazy. So a spider plant is a plant that will grow and it will reproduce itself. And the way it does that, it throws out a shoot, and at the end, these are quite big, you get tiny, tiny baby spider plant on the end. It's still attached to the main body. And you can cut these off and plant them elsewhere, and they'll grow into another spider plant that will grow and produce more baby spider plants. We've cut off loads of these and given them as gifts and things, and it really is amazing. And that's a bit like planting churches. We believe that churches will grow and reproduce and send out and plant other churches. And that's what happened with us, and I'm going to tell the story of that in a little bit, when we were at Southwest London Vineyard and we got planted here. Other plants turn like a little seed, don't they? You have a seed that you put in the ground and they grow and bear fruit, and that will be relevant later as well. Another part of our DNA is that we believe in developing leaders, constantly developing leaders, because that helps the church to grow. If you have leaders who are able to disciple and nurture other believers and raise up other leaders, then we get to grow and we have to move and it becomes dynamic. So constantly you'll see within our story so far, what we seek to do is looking for movement. What is the Lord doing? Who is the Lord raising up as leaders? Who are they going to be able to lead? There's a pastor called Rich Nathan, and he says, leaders don't just appear, you have to train them. So that's why we do a lot of training in leadership. We have small groups where people can grow and train in leadership, because on a Sunday morning, there can only be a few people using their gifts, but in smaller groups and units and other ministries during the week, people can use their gifts and grow and learn, and we can multiply in numbers and leaders and churches eventually. And because Ephesians 4 clearly says the job of a leader is to equip and train the people for acts of service. It's not to do it all themselves, it's to equip and train. And that comes into my next point. A very, very pivotal part of the Vineyard DNA is the idea that everybody gets to play. Sometimes you would have heard this spoken of as equipping the saints or the priesthood of all believers. It simply means all believers get to do all the things that Jesus did. We all get to heal. We all get to cast out demons. We all get to prophesy. We all get to care for the poor and things like that. Everything Jesus did, we get to do. And that's because in Acts 2, it says the Holy Spirit has been poured out on all believers. A Vineyard pastor in South Africa said, Costa Mitchell said, for me, this is one of the non-negotiables of being in the Vineyard and being a leader in the Vineyard, that everybody gets to play in a proper and responsible way that's consistent with our values. So we believe in leadership, but we believe everybody can do stuff. You don't necessarily have to be trained first. We learn as we do. What is the qualification? Do you love Jesus? And sometimes, even if you don't, he uses you as well. So that means all of us. And the way we do that is with no hype and in an unassuming manner, which will be my next point. However, I wanted to just give you a quick example of this. Everyone gets to play, no matter what age you are, no matter what stage you are in your faith. We had, a while ago, in our early days, we had a young lady called Gemma with us, and she had a little girl called Ohana. I think Ohana was probably about 2 at the time. Gemma was a single mum, so she used to come to our small group, and she used to have to bring Ohana with her, so she would be at our small group in the evening. And in our small group, we'd do some worship, some teaching, eat a bit of cake, and then we'd pray for each other by laying hands on and praying for healing and for things that were going on in each other's lives. So Ohana was obviously watching this. She's 2. She didn't study theology. We didn't actually train her in anything, but she was around her church family watching what was happening. Gemma had to go away to Manchester for a bit, and she was on her own with Ohana, and she got really ill with the flu, and she couldn't get out of bed. She said she was lying there with flu, and she just couldn't do anything. And Ohana came over to her, age 2, laid a hand on, said something like, Jesus, Jesus. She just didn't even pray a proper prayer, like we would think. You know, she didn't say the words, in the name of Jesus, be healed, or anything like that. She just laid a hand on, Jesus, Jesus. And the flu left Gemma. Gemma was better. So the Lord pours out the Holy Spirit on all believers in this time that we are in the time where the kingdom, the now and the not yet, is for all of us, all ages. And you don't have to have a degree in theology to play. Jesus gets to give it to all of us, no matter what stage you're at. And that's a distinctive thing that we believe here. And the way that we do that is called being naturally supernatural. So that's my sixth point, being naturally supernatural. We're not looking for emotional manipulation. We're not looking for hype. We're not looking for financial gain. So sometimes in an evening when I'm taking my boys to their swimming training, there's a DJ on Radio 1 called Annie Mack, and she introduces new music. And the other night she was on Radio 1 and she said, "Now I'm going to introduce the hottest track in the world." And I thought, hype? Hottest track in the world? Well, really? Says who? You say that. You're hyping this track up because you want me to think it's the hottest track in the world. I'm just going to listen to it and see if I like it, if I think it actually is a hot track. Because if it is, it'll speak for itself. And that's what we do when we're being naturally supernatural. We worship Jesus and we do the things Jesus did in a way that is natural, without any hype, because he doesn't need it, because he is the hottest track in the world. When Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, not a horse or a chariot, on a donkey, a menial beast, rode into Jerusalem, people were waving the palm fronds, and the Pharisees said to him, "Teacher, quiet down your disciples." They were saying, "He's the king of the Jews." Jesus wasn't saying it. Everyone was saying, "He's the king of the Jews." Children were saying it. Tell your disciples to be quiet, they said. Jesus said, "But if they didn't praise me, even the stones would cry out." We don't need to hype Jesus up. We don't need to have flashing lights. We don't need to be dark. I don't need to shout, scream in your face, because Jesus is powerful enough himself. He can do it himself. So we do things in a naturally supernatural way. The amazing, powerful things of the Lord being done in an everyday manner. And we do that on a Sunday, for a while, you know, wear jeans, and we are informal. And if we do that here, that means we can equip you to do it out there. So if we do things in a natural way here that aren't weird, but sometimes the Holy Spirit comes and it does get a bit weird, that's up to him though. If we don't make it weird here, we can do the same things in the marketplace, in our jobs, in our vocations, in our homes, in a natural way. So it's also an equipping thing. So that is the DNA of any vineyard you go to, should hold those things. But it might look different in different locations, because when you've planted a church or started a church, it should reflect the community that you're part of. So what about our church? What about Corinth Vineyard? I haven't actually got access to a clock.
33,
yes. So I don't want to drone on for too long, so. Our part within that story, what about Corinth Vineyard? So the story of this church so far has been one of God doing extraordinary things through some very ordinary people. It's been a story of God working his wonderful goodness in us, even when things are tough. And as I said, already said, we are a family of God. So hopefully this story, the history of how we started this particular twig of the branch, the family tree of God, was our story, and now it's your story. When you become part of it, it's now your story. And part of you and part of our Sundays and everything we do. So about 5 years ago, because we had our 5-year birthday recently, didn't we? So we've been going for 5 years. About 5 years ago, we were at a church, Tom and I and Phil and Caroline were at a church called Southwest London Vineyard. They met in Putney, but they were a regional church. People came from all over Southwest London. And they said we were working for them, and they said, "We see that you have the ability to gather and the ability to cast vision, because you're doing it already in the small groups and the ministries that you're leading. And we believe that is the ability to church plant." So what they wanted us to do, we were part of the church already, and we had grown like this, leading ministries, and they were saying, we think it's time to cut you off and plant you somewhere else and start a new church. We always described it as an adventure, because it was an adventure. However, it was quite a hard road. So my own personal perspective on it. So we were moving from Worcester Park. We had Phil and Caroline who were going to move to Croydon as well. We had a few others who were going to come with us, but they weren't moving. For me, so my job at the time, my vocation was, I was a stay-at-home mum. I did work for the church one day a week doing the kids' work, but mainly I was a stay-at-home mum, so that was my job. That's why I'm talking about me and the children. I'd spent time investing in the community and my neighbours. I really loved where we were. I was trying to share the gospel with my actual neighbours, with the community. I used to go into Costa Coffee quite a lot, try and read my Bible, share the gospel there, bringing some of the staff to church and things like that. And vineyard planters generally are bivocational. So when you plant, we don't have a building we go to necessarily, our own building. We don't get paid because there's no congregation. So you have to find a job to support your family to actually be able to plant the church. So Tom had to go out and find a job. I had four kids by then. I just had Nathan. The others were four children, six and under, so they were quite young. But we couldn't find a house to move to. We couldn't find a school for the boys. And for me, the worst thing was Nathan was 6 days old and he got sepsis. So we were in hospital and I was thinking, I don't know what's going to happen here. People kept saying to us, if it's right for you, the Lord's going to open doors. If it's right for you, the Lord is going to provide you a house and a job and school and everything will be fine. You will not have a bumpy road. It's just going to happen. That's the way it is. However, I think if I look back at it now, fortunately, we're part of the vineyard. We had Kingdom of God theology. We know Jesus has come, his kingdom has started, but it's not fully started. We're still going to suffer. We're still going to be suffering. It's going to be hard. And we knew that Jesus suffered. He himself had to go to the cross before the resurrection. People hated him, they rejected him, and even his followers, who were doing the right thing, had hardship. So because of our vineyard theology, kingdom theology, we knew that. It doesn't mean it was easy. And sometimes we have hardship and suffering because we've made poor choices and we're unwise. Sometimes we've sinned. So having hardship doesn't necessarily mean we're on the right course. But we knew God had said to us in about 40 words of wisdom and friendship and prophecy that we were to plant a church in Croydon. So we knew that he'd spoken. We knew the trajectory, we'd already been leading things, we knew we'd grown on the plant and we were about to set off, so we could hold on to that. We knew there would be hardship and suffering. But actually, when I look back on, and so Nathan had antibiotics and he was fine after the sepsis, with a few long-term things. But when I look back on it, I think that actually, it was about putting to death the idols that we had in our life. So we had to put to death things like status, social status. Tom used to be a civil servant before he worked for the church, and then he was a sports coach for five-year-olds doing something called play ball to earn money for us to plant. Status, we had to put down our idol of property, having a house we loved, had to let go of that. Possibly not knowing where we were going to live, that's an idol to let go of it. And we had to put the safety of income. We didn't know where the income was going to come from. We didn't know the idol of having a good education for our children. We couldn't find a school to put them in. And actually, the idol of children, I personally had to lay down. Would I hold on to my children more than I would hold on to the Lord? So we had to put those things to death. And it's a bit like we were church planting. The reason they use the word planting, the seed that goes into the ground has to die for the plant to come up. It has to split open for the plant to come up. And now I look back on that time, And I see that the hardship that we face, and let's face it, it's not as much hardship. We weren't beaten, we weren't arrested. Uh-oh, there's an escapee. Someone want to grab a Maya? Maya! I'll just go around to Mummy. Mummy's here this time, so we're all right. But see, that's a split open and die for the plant to live. And so sometimes hardship, I look back on that hardship of that time for me, was a character shaping. And I leaned on the Lord like I'd never leaned on him before. And it was the sweetest of times in other ways. Because you can trust him when times are good and times are bad. And we knew God had spoken. And he had spoken many times and told us through many different people. We wouldn't just go on one word of knowledge. There were many people, and our senior pastors had said, we see this in you, let's do it. So we could go in the confidence of that. In about March 2013, we were 7 adults and 6 kids. We were sent out to Croydon, to Park Croydon Vineyard, in our house in South Croydon. Because we are churches who plant churches. And we would hope to do the same. We would hope the Lord is stirring up leaders who would plant new churches from here eventually, and so on and so on. The kingdom gets extended. One of the first things we did was we hired the Fairfield Halls for 4 nights. We had come and see evenings. We don't have Sunday services, but if we did, this is what it would look like. Come and see. Free food, free drink. We printed 10,000 flyers. We hyped it up. You probably know where this is going now. We hyped it up, come on. We went out on the streets. We handed out anyone we could find. We handed out, put it in phone booths, went door to door, handed out free chocolate. Went on the streets with face painting and balloons and praying for people on the streets, the station, wherever we were. I was opposite at that point because we still hadn't found schools for the boys. I was homeschooling, so whenever we went out to do PE in the park, I'd give out flyers to all the mums who were around there. Hey, do you know about Jesus? Do you want to come? I lost the boys. Who do you think we should give these to? And they'd help. And we thought it was going to be great. We invited all our friends from South West on the VR to come so that there was a party atmosphere. And it wouldn't be empty, put it all over social media, in the newspapers. And we thought, this is what the Lord has. He's told us to plant. If you book them, they will come. Okay, but the Lord doesn't do things like that. We weren't, I don't know whether we were listening already or not. But the first night, there was a handful of people. And we had to look at that and we had to say, are we hyping this up? Are we doing what the Lord's doing? Are we doing what we're doing? What we think he wants? And are we looking at this success in numbers? Or are we looking at people who come alive in Jesus? People who matter, the individuals who matter. And over the course of those next 4 weeks, we had a smattering of people and we realized that the Lord was sending us the most amazing people. So I'd love it if you came to any of those come and see evenings, could you just stand up? I don't know if anyone's here this morning. Could you just stand up if you came to those come and see evenings? Woohoo! Some of them are down, some of them are serving on the kids' teams this morning and things like that. But that is enough. So what we found was those people who came became the foundations of the church. And the Lord said, I want you to work with them and love them. Love the people I'm sending you in a natural, supernatural way. And you don't need to hype it up. You don't need to do the big things. So often we don't do the big events. We do small personal things. Because what we actually found was we would have people around for dinner and we would talk and pray and invest in them that way. And that, for us and our personalities, that bore much more fruit than doing big events. We do sometimes now do big events, but it's always about the people because we're relational. It's always about the people. After the Fairfield Halls events, there were about 15 to 20 adults. We'd meet in our house in the mornings for bacon butties and a bit of worship. Kids in one room, adults in the other. Eventually we outgrew that. We met in the Treehouse pub and gathered a few more people. We thought it would be a cool venue, but it was a little bit rank. And it took a lot of effort. It was so dark because it was a nightclub. And at first I was like, yeah, this is really cool. Church in a nightclub. Oh yeah, this is where it's at. But actually it was like black and you couldn't see the speaker. Had to hook up all these lights just to see the speaker's face and the worship leader. And we were still about 15 to 20 people, so that was a lot of work. So if you ever came to one of those treehouse pub events, could you stand up? It'd be great to know you. Yeah. Oh yeah. Brilliant. See, there were a few more. Let's give them a clap. A few more people joined. And then in January 2014, we had our first Sunday service. A wonderful morning in Croydon Council Training Facility on the 8th floor of Leon House. They're now turning it into some flats on South End. It was on the 8th floor. Had a great view of Croydon where we were worshipping. However, it was like running the gauntlet to get to the 8th floor because you had to park in special places. You had to buzz a certain buzzer. The doorman sometimes opened the door, sometimes didn't. And you had to get in the right lift to get to the 8th floor. They didn't all even go up to the 8th floor. So any time someone new arrived, we were constantly amazed that they'd actually made it there. And praising the Lord, just simply for that. About a year after being there, we were up to about 60 adults and kids, and we were starting to feel squashed, so we moved here to St. Andrew's School. We met, first of all, in the sixth form block. We're a live meet now. And we've grown in number since, and we've moved to here, to the main Sunday. We've now got evening services as well. Because we continue to grow, and because the Father's always working, we believe he's going to continue to do that. So we started small groups during the week because as we grow bigger, we need to maintain strong relationships. And also because we want to develop leaders. Small group is a great way of developing your leadership. Because if you're slightly unconfident, it's a little bit easier to do something in a smaller group with people who you've been meeting with and more intimate with than sometimes up here. So we've been going for 5 years now. So happy birthday, Croydon Vineyard. And just as a little bit of fun, earlier before the service, my children planted bars of chocolate under some seats. So if you'd like to have a look under your seat, you may have a bar of chocolate taped, just as a bit of fun. Because we've been going 5 years. Happy birthday, Croydon Vineyard, it should be four. Them. Oh yeah, I can see two, yes, three. I hope they haven't melted before. Yes. I hope they haven't melted because it's quite like it. So just a bit of fun, because it's the 5th birthday. It's a happy birthday. The Lord, you know, he's lavishly generous, and nothing says happy birthday like a bar of chocolate, eh? Although you're probably sick of it, I just realised because it's been Easter, we may have overindulged. Anyway, happy birthday. But Sundays are only a portion of what we've been doing. I've tracked it from Sundays. It's only a portion of what we've been doing. Right from the start, we've tried to be a place where people can grow in fun, healing friendships, a church full of people who really love each other and are there for each other, and people who live out our belief that God works in the ordinary and the painful as much as the impressive and the easy. That's why we tell the stories of things that don't seem to work as well as the stories of things that do. We have loads of social events, so just social events, because we want to be relational and get to know each other. We have small groups in our homes throughout the week, like I said, that raises up leaders and forms strong relationships, especially as we get bigger. And another significant part of our story is our growing work in the community. So as I said, Phil and Caroline Greaves moved to Croydon with us. We couldn't believe it at the time, we thought. Who's going to move house from a plant the church with us that doesn't even exist? We're not even approved church planters yet. So we were always amazed that they did that, but they did. They came and planted, and they had a real gifting and a real heart for community stuff. So we now employ them as our community pastors, but they were doing it already before they came on staff. So for the last few years, we've been out on the streets most weeks doing street cafe, being naturally supernatural. We just hand out teas and coffees, sometimes chocolate. We chat to people in an ordinary way, say hello and ask them, would you like to be prayed for? We don't then take them off into a prayer booth that we've made that's dark so we can concentrate and got a smoke machine, although that would be pretty cool. You know, the smoke machine and stuff like that, to pray for them. We do it on the streets. Just lay on a hand, ask the Lord to come. Because it's actually supernatural. The Lord can do amazing things in the everyday place, on the street. Doesn't have to be in church, doesn't have to go somewhere else, don't have to do something weird, just normal. We've seen many people encounter Jesus through these times, and through the many foreign language peoples we encountered, we started the Vineyard English School. So we've had the Vineyard English School going. It offers free conversational English lessons to anyone who wants them, and we've got many, many stories from the English School. However, I just want to give one. There was an Iranian family who were claiming asylum in the UK. They were invited by one of our teams to something that Antoinette used to run called Make It Crafts. So sharing the love of God, not by doing anything weird or hyped, but by doing craft. Ladies would get together, do craft, chat the gospel, gossip the gospel. And an Iranian family came to one of those. They came along and they felt really loved and welcomed. They were then invited along to a church event the next week in a local cafe. The family were due to leave the following day, but they came along anyway and had a great time. The next day they were relocated by the Home Office to Cardiff. So we put them in touch with Cardiff Vineyard, who went to visit them. When they were moved on again, because this tends to be what happens, to Swansea, the team at Cardiff Vineyard linked them in with another local church there who befriended them. And soon after they arrived in Swansea, the whole family made professions of faith in Jesus Christ and were baptized. So we are again the tapestry. We are a thread in the tapestry of the global church. We love the church, the other churches, and we work together, but we do things with a certain flavour. So this story, a very brief story, if you come to one of our welcome lunches, we give it in a bit more detail. This is the story of the Vineyard, the story of the family of God. The Vineyard is part of that, a branch of that, and we as Croydon Vineyard are a twig of that story. It was our story when we started it. As you join the church and become part of this family, it's now your story, and you get to be part of this and do the things that's happening in the church. And what we do is what we see the Father doing. So there's many things we could be doing, many things, but we want to do what we see the Father doing in Croydon and do that. Otherwise, we're working hard for no fruit. So I'm going to get a bit practical now, and you're going to get to do this. I'm going to do an example of everyone gets to play. We all get to do the stuff. You don't have to be special, you don't have to be the pastor, you don't have to be trained, although I'm going to do a little bit of training. So I'm going to show you how some of this works with prayer ministry. So can I get a volunteer up front? Let me see. Can I get Kenny to come up front? Don't worry, I see. You don't have to say anything. Okay, so one thing that we like to do, can we come up here? One thing we like to do, so what I've described is who we are, where we come from, and the values of why we do what we do in the way we do it. God can work anyway, can't he? God can do anything. But we've got a value system, a way of doing this, we believe we've seen him work time and time again. So one thing we do, we worship this morning, we've given a talk, and we like to give a chance for prayer ministry. So let's just run through how we like to do that and why we do that. So the first thing is, someone says they want some prayer. So let's say Kemi has come to me and says she wants some prayer. This is something we do on a Sunday, but because we do it naturally, supernaturally, you can do it anywhere. Do it on the street, do it at home. I've prayed for people in the playground before, other moms in the playground. You can do it anywhere, really, in a coffee shop. So Kemi's come and she says she wants to do prayer. What she wants to be prayed for. Now, prayer ministry is slightly different than intercession. When we are, or we're talking to God for ourselves, or we're just praying about things, it's someone coming saying, I've got a need, I want to meet with God. So my primary aim for Kemi is that she meets with God, and I don't want to get in the way. When we teach the children this, we say, stand like this. In your head, not actually saying. Like a drain pipe. If you imagine yourself as a drain pipe, then in the Holy Spirit come through you to the person, then you're not thinking that you are the Holy Spirit or that you have to do something or say something to the person. We are allowing her to engage with God, but we are stewarding. So best thing to do is ask what you would like prayer for. Can you make something up, or is that too much?
Just
say.
Memory.
Memory.
Memory. Sometimes it's a physical thing they want healing for, and sometimes it's emotional.
After my health. Yeah.
Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, so I could just go, oh, thanks for telling me that, Kemi. I pray that you get better, Kemi. Get better. What's she going to feel if I do that? She doesn't know what I'm doing, does she? She doesn't know what I'm doing. So I'll say, Kemi, I'm just going to pray for you. And the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to put a hand on you. Like this, if you want to, you can receive from God however you want. So if you want to close your eyes, it might help you to focus. Some people put their hands out, but you don't have to do that, just whatever makes you feel comfortable. That's going to make her feel better, isn't it? And that's not weird, is it? You don't want to be weird. So I've told her what I'm going to do. I'm going to put a hand on her to pray for her. And I'm going to invite the Holy Spirit to come. Now, this is something we can do anywhere. You can be in the coffee shop, and you can pray for someone like this. You can be on the streets and pray for someone like this. Okay, slightly weird, but it's not like weird. So I put a hand on her and I say, Holy Spirit, come, because I'm inviting the Holy Spirit to come and move. And this is the really difficult part, really difficult. So difficult to do this. I just wait. It's not really that difficult, is it? I wait, and while I'm waiting, I don't want to jump in, I'm saying, Father, what are you doing here? Because she might have said, I want prayer for my physical healing, but maybe the Lord wants to do something else. And if I think, oh, I know what she needs, I'm not listening to God. I want her to encounter the Holy Spirit and God. So I pray like that. What are you doing here, Father? What are you doing? And wait. And then we participate with him. We don't need to babble on with a massive long prayer. So if then I'm standing here and then I start to pray and cry, she's not going to know what's going on. If I'm just silent the whole time, she's not going to know what's going on. But if I do want to pray out loud, I'll praise her that she can hear, she can agree. And the other thing is I'm keeping my eyes open. Why am I doing that? Because we believe in the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is here. It's within us, it's near. We don't need to go and retreat somewhere, try really hard to find the kingdom of God to pray. The kingdom of God is here. It's naturally supernatural. I'm just standing here praying. God's doing his stuff. I'm not hyping it up. I'm not summoning him up. God is doing his stuff. God can speak for himself. That means you can do that anywhere. Because again, it's not weird. And it's a skill to learn to pray with your eyes open. But that's why we do that. The other reason is a practical reason, because I could be praying like this, praying so hard for Kemi, and she's there, she's bored. Like, nothing's happening for her, it's happening for me, it's not happening for her. Or, I've got my eyes closed and I'm praying, she could have walked away, because she's done. I'm still praying, and that is weird, isn't it? It's for her benefit, not my benefit. And if we feel like God is saying, sometimes when we're praying, we believe in prophecy in this church, words of knowledge, words of encouragement. I might feel I'm praying for your body to be healed. Okay, but I feel like God is saying there's something about your memory. This is fabricated, but it's like an example. The reason I say that I feel like God might be saying something about your memory is because we don't hype. We're naturally supernatural. And from prophetic things, 1 Corinthians says, prophecy is not a complete picture. Okay, for now we see, it's like looking through a glass. We see in part, so a bit like catchphrase, we say what we see. When Jesus returns, we'll see face to face, and there'll be no more prophecy, because we'll see face to face, we see now. And sometimes we get it wrong. So we don't want to hype, and we don't want to proclaim stuff. Kemi, the Lord says, your memory is, because that's hype. And I might get it wrong. I think the Lord might be saying to you, Kemi, this. Does that seem right to you? Okay? And 1 Corinthians 14 also says, prophecy should comfort, strengthen, and encourage the person it's given to. So for this reason, we're careful of giving prophecies which involve exposing someone's secret sins or telling them who to marry. The Lord has told me that you should marry so me. No, that is. Sometimes the Lord does speak to us about secret sin. However, be very careful about how you share that, and I would suggest getting wisdom from someone else before. And sometimes it's just for you to pray about it. Because we don't want to be manipulative, we don't want to hype, and it's to encourage and strengthen. Brilliant. And in terms of her healing, we have the kingdom theology of the now and the not yet. The kingdom of God does break through us, and we see amazing healing and miracles, but sometimes he does something else, and we don't see the physical healing yet until Jesus returns. So what I don't do is I don't proclaim over Kemi, you are healed. When clearly, if she's got a broken leg, your leg is healed. It's healed. And she walks off and it's still broken. Because that's lying, kind of like lying. Okay? So we just pray. Sometimes if we see healing, sometimes don't. Let's pray again about that. Let's ask God again. Because otherwise it depends on the person's faith. It depends on them. We can manipulate that. And actually it's about God. God doing the stuff. So we don't guarantee healing because we have the kingdom theology. When Jesus returns and makes all things new, there'll be no more praying for healing because we'll be made new. There'll be no more suffering and death. But until then, there is sometimes. So, why don't we stand? Okay, so let's get a good practice of this. Far too long, I should have a watch up here, I'm so sorry. Is there anyone who would like, has got something physical they'd like God to heal this morning? We're going to call you forward.